Glad to have you. We really appreciate you taking the time to come out and join us. These, venture to say, it's your biggest group of fans.
You know, certainly it's nice to go to a show where everybody wants to see me, as opposed to a show where everybody wants to see somebody else.
Indeed.
So, yes. I just wanted to say a brief thing here. Please. We've known about TravelerCon. You've kept us informed on this for several years now. And Greg Lee and I interacted and said that we wanted to come out here. We thought it would be a great time to come and see everybody and have a good time. And I had never met Greg Lee in person. And so he and I made our plans late last year that we would come out this year and started working towards this. And alas, and we all know, he died suddenly on Easter afternoon. And so he isn't here. But I can't help but think of him and what we would have talked about and done and the fun that we would have had if he'd come. So.
Yeah, an integral part of the fan base.
Yeah. Now, just Greg Lee, you know, I had never met him. And yet he wrote Lee's Guide to Adventure.
Yep.
He's been around for a long time. He went away from Traveler for a while, came back. He is the one who inspired me, encouraged me to start writing nonfiction. I think he has a turn of phrase in Traveler that was just incredible. And so I encouraged him to write his novel. He was writing his novel about the circus. And he spent his time, he would send me chapters or scenes, and I would read them, and I would love them. And I had to keep encouraging him to finish, because he was a busy man, a professional, he had work to do. The one that stuck with me is that he's writing about Shodani secret agents, operatives sent to work within the Imperium. And he talks about them having to take dishonesty lessons.
Yes.
He had an ability to see see and express the deep cultural differences in alien societies. He finished his novel. He finished it. He had it completed and edited a bare 3 weeks before he died. I even had it reviewed by Shannon Appleklein, who is a well-known game reviewer, before, but he didn't see the review before it was done, before he died. Our plan is to do a Kickstarter for that novel sometime in the spring, on the anniversary of his passing. And unfortunately, he wanted it to be a trilogy or a 20-ology. He really had grand designs on what he should have. We've only got the one, but it really is, more than anything, this snapshot of Imperial society after the Fifth Frontier War. He just did a magnificent job, and I think it stands alone. So,
we look forward to seeing that then on Kickstarter.
Yeah. So,
yes.
Now we're ready for questions, but I wanted to digress.
Yeah. No, thank you. Thank you for sharing. So the format that we have, many of you know, when you registered for the con, you were asked if you wanted to submit a question for the lecture. I've broken things out. Hopefully you are here in the assigned lecture that you signed up for. Either way, regardless, welcome. So I will ask the questions to Mark. I also have a couple of other additional ones that we'll throw in there. After a time, we will then go to a Q&A. So once we get those questions satisfied, then we'll go to a general Q&A. We will have it in a controlled manner. So we'll call on folks, et cetera, and we'll let Mark complete his thoughts with things. All right, but in the meantime, I'll go ahead and start with some of the questions that have been submitted.
And he hasn't shown me these questions. So.
On purpose.
Yeah. On purpose.
So first one. Why is minimum safe jump distance based on planet size rather than mass?
Hey, good question. Why does Traveler not echo the real world in terms of very deep, complex scientific calculations, and instead uses a simple approximation that's easy to calculate and easy to understand? And that's the question, that's why we do it. Because it's easier to say it in terms of diameters of a world than it is, oh, by the way, you should calculate that in addition to us knowing the diameter of the world, you should also know its mass and thus the gravity gradient. Because those all, it's not essential to the problem. And that's why we, you know, we aren't three-dimensional. We tried three-dimensional in 2300 AD, and it's hard to wrap your mind around it, and it slows us down. You know, I struggled with three dimensions, but at most, all we ever care about in three dimensions is three places. Me, start, end, or me, him, and something we're in relationship to. And that defines a plane. It's all we care about. You know, if there are four of them, it's a group over there of two, makes one point. It's, you know, the Star Wars movie, they talk about, they show you something in three dimensions. You notice there are little maps of the Death Star coming from behind the gas, and it is two dimensions. It's not a holographic 3D thing. It's almost there, okay, there, we can see it. Simplicity itself. That's one.
Thank you. Let's see. So, could you explain how you came up with the social aspects of the Jodani, which is now I've heard that pronounced? Anybody ever have that question? How do you pronounce it?
So let me know.
So, Jodani.
Yes.
Yes? Could you explain how you came up with the social aspects of the Jodani culture?
Frank Chadwick made these names up. I don't know why, and I don't know what they were supposed to be, but he made up a couple of names, and Jodani was one of them. And we wanted psionics to be in there somewhere. And so we assigned it to the Jodani. And then the thought was, how does that work? How do you have psionics in a society? John Harshman came up with the social structure. And he did because he said, if everybody could read minds, if everybody could do all this stuff, what would society be like? And he said, it's hard for that to be a society that we can understand. Because you bypass all of the frailties of humanity. And people can talk mind to mind and they can, much like three dimensions or 2D space, it's hard to get your mind around. So we had to get something that was not too far away from what we think of as traditional culture. But it's also, there's a reason for the structure. There's a reason for the culture that we created, who is in, it's compare and contrast with Empire. Now, we use a lot of templates or examples or metaphors as we try and explain things. And one of the people come to me and say, this world can't be like this. These numbers don't work on a UWP. And you know, there's some barrier, some obstruction in their mind that they can't see how you can have, you know, high law level and low population, or low population and high population and low law level, or whatever those things are. And I always encourage people to really struggle through and make those numbers work, because they ultimately show us some aspect of society. You know, they say, if we had high tech on one world, it would be everywhere. Well, high tech is Silicon Valley. But we can't make disk drives in Bloomington, Illinois. We can use them, but we can't make them. They can't even use them in Nambia, I think the word is. there are, so this, let me step back. And so we were trying to show with the Judani culture a society that had addressed all of the social ills that we see. What is that society like? The Judani hate, not so much hate, fear, don't understand imperial society because they think imperial society is dishonest, intellectually and morally dishonest, that people in imperial society, much like our society here, say one thing and do another, lie, cheat, and steal, and yet the society stays together because we found how to make imperial or American society work without having perfect honesty. We strive for it, but it doesn't work. And the Judani can't understand how that works. Now the Imperials can't understand how people would tolerate someone else reading their mind. How does it work that, how would you live in a society where if you start to kind of ruminate about how bad the world is and how bad your life is, and start to either descend into depression or into berserkness or whatever, and the Judani, the authorities, can sense that, they see that, they come in, they help you, and they take you away and put you back in society as a functioning member.
Would that be welcomed by that?
Oh, everybody welcomes it.
Yeah.
But there are ways in role-playing that are hard to do that fiction lets us talk about differently. That's why I'm enjoying doing science fiction as narrative instead of as role-playing, because we can see other aspects of these societies. Because they assign people jobs. I mean, it's a managed society where people take care of things, and people do, but eventually somebody comes down to the society, the economy has turned south, and there aren't jobs in this sector for these people. And somebody from the Tabar Chedle, the guardians of our morality, come in, and they're, we think of them as secret police. They think of them as the mental health society. They come in and they will counsel this person that he's no longer going to be able to work at the car factory because it's closed down because of the economy. And instead they help retrain him to be a sewage worker. And he's happy, makes reasonable money. He's happy with the level of money that he makes, so he's happy. And society is better for that. Who wouldn't want that?
Right.
Say the Judani.
Right.
The Imperials say, you're crazy. Can't you see what's wrong with your society?
Yeah.
And that was what John Harshman was aiming for, is a perfect society. But Traveler is not about perfect society. There's always those flaws, those things to talk about. Which is also, the die rolls in Traveler are not reflective of all of society. That they're the people, clearly there are millions of people who will never leave home, who will never venture beyond their city, state, or their continent, or their region, or their world, or even their system. But we have something we call the traveler gene. There are people who have that gene who just have to travel. They aren't the Bill Gates of the world. They aren't the ones who make the fortunes. They may aspire to it, but that's not what they're about. They want to get up and move. And that's the traveler is. That's who the travelers are. That's the people. There are whole societies, whole species in traveler that don't seem to have that traveler gene. And they're just, we go visit them, we go meet them. But they're not the ones who are adventuring from world to world.
Thank you. All right, so are there any adventures planned using the agent from your book?
The book already has the core rules already tell you how to do it. So anybody could run an agent. They could create a character as an agent and make one work. I don't have anything specifically in terms of role-playing planned to create an agent or create an agent adventure. So how many have read the novel? If you haven't, spoilers, you know, you can. So is the Dacus, you know what the Dacus area is? Space heaven. Is that real? In Traveler, is it real? Is it in the story? Is it real? Right. That's And I have some people who say absolutely insist it's real. It's a phenomenon. If in the Traveler universe, it's real. They want to start accumulating their dead characters and adventuring there. And so literally if they recreate a character who begins dead, we're going to get a bunch of those guys and they're going to get together and go adventuring and exploring the Dacus area. I don't know where that's going to
go. But to follow on then to that, are you planning any additional books, novels, and or anything specific about the agent? Well, I mean, it kind of ended with, was it Margaret?
Right.
Are you looking to continue that timeline, you think, or?
I'm influenced by Christopher Rowley's Vang series. He wrote a series of three. The Vang is an omni-species parasitic life form that basically can parasitize anything. Animals, people, aliens, anybody. And his concept is that they roamed the universe a long time ago. They weren't especially smart, but that was okay because they could just take over anything, you know. And they were vanquished a long time ago. The first is the story of Starhammer, where they were conquering some species which invented something that would nova their star in retaliation, and so it destroyed their civilization. But there are little groups of them around, spores, so to speak. And so that's that first story. The next story in the series is 3,000 years later, and totally new characters. And the next one after that is 1,000 years after that, as we see different aspects of it. So I'm writing another story. I want to write more than that. I'm not sure that those characters or Jonathan Bland will appear. Jonathan is capable of appearing. And we may see him in the next one slightly, but I don't see him as a continuing character in specifically the next story. But then he could pop up in the next one. There's a problem in having him crop up because people new to the series open it up and say, who's he? And I have to do a lot of explaining. So I am looking at, so a long time ago, let's start over. I look at the Imperium is supposedly this cosmopolitan, eclectic universe and government where everybody is free and happy, you know. And there are people who do things wrong, that's okay, but we're dedicated to honor and everything else. Yet there are flaws in that story. You know, that If you've read, as you read the novel, you find people casually use racial slurs. Just sometimes not even conscious that that's what that is. They make assumptions that just because it's an alien species that they aren't quite as good as humans. There's all those things of less than perfection in society. And I want to address that in the next story. There are parts of it that are dark. I'm not very good at writing dark, so I'm sure we'll see what happens.
Yes.
But I would like to do a series of these stories, you know, carrying us forward to where we get to the Imperium in the Golden Age and beyond.
Thank you. All right. Let's see. Would you please outline the plans and if possible, a rough timetable for any continued development of Traveler 5?
PDF is currently traveler5.09. I would like to, I have the information to make it 5.10 exactly, in terms of Arana and such. 5.09 primarily was implementing the index. And so once I do that, and I seem to have a lot of things to do, and I'm not terribly pressed to do it, but when I do, then I'll reprint that book probably next year sometime. I would like to do a player's manual, probably in the 6x9 format, 240 pages, just what players need, foldouts and everything else, but something that a player can sit here and there's stuff that the player doesn't need out of the big book. Like to do that. Beyond that, I'm just enjoying working on it.
Go back in time a little bit here. Who is handling the errata for Mega Traveler? And somebody's been busy. Would you like a set of Mega Traveler canon with all of the corrections inserted into it?
Is that in a text file?
Can I put you on the spot, Eric?
Put on the spot.
Quickly. Yeah.
I have gone through on the player's manual, the referee's manual, the Imperial Encyclopedia, the referee's companion, COAC, Rebellion Source Book, the essays for fighting ships. I don't know that the ships themselves are salvageable. I have a full copy of Adobe Acrobat, and I can control C, control V, and I have been steadily, over the past 2 years, been going through it, putting in all the corrections and stuff. The documents got a little bit bigger, I gotta warn you. The referee's manual is now about 145 pages. In addition to that, what else have I got done with that? The font size is slightly larger because my eyes aren't getting any better. I have worked through, I know we're, as far as the errata thread on Cody, we're about 300 messages behind. And, you know, I'm at a stop point right now.
Well, but you know, what a labor of love, and thank you. Because, you know, we all pick our little things that we are also about and care about, and I appreciate that. And yes, I want that. And yes, I want to put that up on drive-thru so people can get at it and have it, because the small group of people that wants that and would be happy to have it, yes, we want to make that available.
That makes sense. You two of you get together after.
Yep.
So, all right. And thanks, Eric. All right, on here. So how much, if any, role do you take in reviewing products by third party, such as Mongoose?
I have what I call an inner circle of people who look at everything. And often if something is sent to me, I will forward it to them. Kevin Knight, sort of the night. He did Traveler Chronicle. He's got a game store in Kentucky. And he wanted to write a Traveler novel. So he sent it to me. He said, I got this done. And I sent it to, I mean, I've got a list of maybe 15 people that I talk to regularly or semi-regularly. And I picked out a couple that I thought would be interested in reading this novel. And I sent it to them. And I told Kevin, when I get some feedback, I'll give it to you. And they did. And they came back and they said, you're using the wrong terms here, and this doesn't work, and your writing is terrible here, and you need to improve it this way. And he used that. And he's coming close to having a novel that will not look bad in either for his name or for mine. That's what happens. On the other hand, I have, you know, there are the standards that Traveler is not Star Trek and is not Star Wars, and so you don't do those things. If you're just riffing Star Wars or Star Trek or whatever, it's not going to work. It's also, if it's going to be beyond G-rated, it's not going to work. I mean, I literally, there are points where I talk to people and I just have that blunt conversation. If that's what you want to write about, find someplace else. Because that's not what Traveler does. It just messes up the good, fun time that people are having. And we see some products out there where those are the themes. The people are buying those for Dungeons and Dragons, but I just don't want to see it. It just leads us down the wrong path. And so, pretty firm on that. I am firm on that. And once they say, oh, I understand completely and I'm totally on board, then they can do all kinds of things.
Yeah. As far as like Mongoose, yeah, or any of these like the third parties,
right,
do they send you the material ahead of time? Here's what we're looking to do? Or
they usually send me a proposal.
And
they send me the proposal and I say, oh, that's not going to work, or how are you possibly going to deal with that concept there? And once they do, then we go to final manuscript, and I see those. Several people see them before they go.
Okay. Thank you.
Doesn't mean they're perfect. It just means that they're not terrible.
Fair enough. All right. I know, I think I've heard you answer this one before. Twofer here. Do you know or believe that Joss Whedon played Traveler? Tied in with the second question on that is, continuation essentially, what is your take on Firefly, the TV series?
I haven't seen Firefly. So, I've heard about it, I've looked it up in Wiki, but I haven't seen it, so I can't tell you that I know. It sounds good. I appreciate that. And I have seen the discussion, a very recent discussion with Josh Whedon, taking published interview sources and pointing out that he says he played role-playing in college and that Firefly is based on his play of that in college. And he certainly wasn't playing Universe or Starfare, you know, or Star Frontiers, that, in genealogy, there are things you can't prove. We'd need to, get him under oath or something. But all of the evidence we have says that it's based on his, and very little evidence to tell you that, oh no, he was using some other system, because he was using Traveler. It's got to be the little black books, he always starts using Traveler. And when you try to make a movie or a script, you're writing down to an audience that doesn't care about how planets orbit worlds. They don't care how many planets, or do they all orbit the same sun, or they don't. The audience just cares about point A and point B. They don't care about three dimensions in any real sense. Just they want it to look pretty. And so he just made up a bunch of ideas, made them work. Just like Star Wars, I don't know how that space fighter moves from this star system to that star system. Whoosh and whoosh. And nobody cares in a story sense. We can explain it somehow, but I don't know how that works. And it doesn't matter. In the same way with the universe that Josh Whedon created.
All right, what is the single biggest piece of advice you would give to someone who is looking to produce their own role-playing game system?
Just one? Just one piece of advice?
Just single, but I would take, we'll take whatever you're willing to give.
No matter what you're doing,